Mr. President, unfortunately, our Democratic friends have now blocked another vital piece of legislation from moving forward by a vote of 54 to 42, the cloture vote on the pain-capable Unborn Child Protection Act has failed on that cloture vote. But I just want to point out to our colleagues, this is not the end of this discussion. This is the beginning of the discussion once again. I would point out that over the years, we've actually been making some progress in favor of an agenda which favors life. In 2007, 8 Senate Republicans opposed defunding Planned Parenthood. By 2011, 5 Senate Republicans opposed defunding Planned Parenthood. And in August, just 1 Republican senator opposed it by filibustering, voting to filibuster the bill. Last time we had 0 Democrat senators vote in support of such a measure. In August, we got 2. The pain-capable bill that was blocked by Senate Democrats last year, of course, is what we just voted on again. And today we had an opportunity to be on the record and advocate for what is a top priority for pro-life groups. So, Mr. President, there is legislation that's passed in the House of Representatives, namely the Born Alive piece of legislation, which really doesn't, I think, shouldn't divide Congress the way that perhaps the defund Planned Parenthood bill has. Because at some point, whether you're pro-choice or pro-life, hopefully we can agree that a child that's basically grown to full term in its mother should be protected from the abortion industry. And I think we're going to have other opportunities to vote on that issue. But the Pain-Capable Unborn Child Protection Act is really a moral imperative for our nation. It says a lot about who we are as a country. This chamber just had the opportunity to send a clear message that America is a nation that seeks to advance a culture of life and opportunity for everyone, particularly those who are the most vulnerable. As a father of 2 daughters, I don't understand the rationale of some of my colleagues on the other side. Do they believe that there should be no limitation on access to abortion at all? No limit? Well, we'll have an opportunity for another vote that perhaps will give them a chance to go on record on the Born Alive bill that passed the House of Representatives last week. Unfortunately, I think it appears that by blocking this vote, some of our colleagues were simply unable to cast aside the pressures of special interest groups to take a stand for life. But it's important to note for pro-life members like myself that protecting the sanctity of life is an ongoing mission, and it doesn't end with this one vote. Mr. President, briefly on another matter, I'd ask that the Senate be in order.
Senate will be in order.
Mr. President, on another matter, we will shortly consider or reconsider another vote that should be a clear-cut issue. This vote would make sure that our military has what they need in order to protect our country and deal with the rising and diverse threats to national security occurring around the world. This will most pointedly help our troops maintain their status as the greatest military. The Defense Appropriations Bill includes simple initiatives that make sense and serve our troops well, like giving them a well-deserved pay raise. And I think it's worth reminding those here today that this will be the second opportunity to move this legislation forward. Earlier, our colleagues across the aisle blocked this Defense Appropriation Bill that provides critical funding for our troops and refused to allow it to move forward. That legislation, as the Majority Leader pointed out, was voted overwhelmingly out of the Appropriations Committee in June, with the support of many of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle who then turned and voted against it on the floor. I guess in the famous words of John Kerry, they were for it before they were against it. So the bill we'll be considering and voting on here shortly is not a piece of partisan legislation. But holding up this legislation is unfortunately indicative of a larger strategy of keeping the Senate tied in knots and making it impossible for us to function as it was intended. And if the goal is to stymie real progress, I would have to congratulate our friends across the aisle. But unfortunately, they've taken as a hostage in this partisan political fight the very military that they claim to support, and I believe they do support, but their vote certainly does not indicate that when they vote against funding our troops. So I would point out that in 2013, the Democratic leader himself advocated for something we call regular order around here when it comes to setting our nation's fiscal policy. Fortunately, this year under the new majority, we were able to pass a budget for the first time since 2009. But then what should have happened after that is the Appropriations Committee should have done its work, and in fact, it did do its work. And then those bills would come to the floor and they would be voted on by the Senate. But that is what our Democratic colleagues have blocked, but I think they've gone a bridge too far in blocking the funding for our military, particularly with the headlines we see in the newspapers and the conflicts arising and spreading across the world. So this is the first time in 6 years that the Appropriations Committee has approved and reported out all 12 appropriations bills. But then these bills became hostage to something our Democratic friends call filibuster summer, a political strategy telegraphed in the pages of the Washington Post just last June to block all appropriations bills. I said it then, and it bears repeating, that stifling debate and blocking votes is a pretty lousy political strategy, and it's not what the American people sent us here to do. It's what lost my friends across the aisle control of this chamber nearly a year ago. It's a losing strategy, it's bad policy, and it's cynical politics. And it's simply shameful to take these partisan political fights to the point of denying our troops the resources they need in order to do their job. So the Appropriations Committee has done its work on a bipartisan basis and painstakingly drafted, considered, and passed all 12 appropriations bills. Now this chamber should do our job and move those appropriation bills forward, starting with the defense appropriation bill. So now that the majority leader has moved to reconsider that failed vote earlier, blocked by our Democratic colleagues, I hope our friends across the aisle have had a chance to reconsider and to think carefully about the ramifications of their decision, and that they will join us in moving this bill forward. The world is far too dangerous, and the threats are far too real to take this important piece of legislation hostage and prevent the resources going to the troops who simply deserve it. Quite simply, we have no time to lose when it comes to fulfilling one of our most basic duties to the American people, defending against threats to national security. So I'd urge my fellow colleagues to join me in moving this important bill forward.